So now I welcome you to Kruje, Albania. It's a mountaintop city just north of Tirana by like, I don't know, 45 minutes to an hour. Today we're going to walk through one of the very important foundational stories for modern Albania, and that is the story about Skanderbeg, probably the most famous historical figure from Albanian history, someone who has a square named for him in the center of Tirana. And the story starts in Kruje, in this city, the statues there. And I can't wait to tell you about this illustrious story that most people don't have the chance to hear about. From here we can see Skanderbeg on his horse, diligently looking out upon the valley that lays below Kruje. Behind us is one of the most important castles for the defense of this region from the Ottoman Empire, a story I'll get into in much detail in a second. And behind there is a historical museum that we'll check out as well. So I was gonna tell you guys the story of Skanderbeg right here, but I've got this group of homies here. That's it.
It's Albania.
Albania, yes. And this guy, love it. Those kids were hilarious, saying terrible things. Classic 9-year-old boys to 11-year-old boys. Very funny. I digress. On to the history. To give you guys the full contextual story of Skanderbeg, I think I have to go back in time a little bit and start from ancient history. The Albanians come from the Illyrian people. The Illyrian people have inhabited this part of the Balkan Peninsula for, I mean, as long as people really have been taking history. And they were a kind of paganistic, religious people. Then they were absorbed into the Roman Empire in about 100 BC. But before that, they were doing their own thing. The Illyrian language is really where the Albanian language kind of comes from or is derived from, or at least that's what people think. Albanian is known as an Indo-European language, meaning that it is this big connection between the northern Indian people moving across Central Asia and into Europe, creating the different languages that you find in Europe today. Albanian, however, is very strange and people don't know exactly where to place it. So this could be that connection with the Illyrians and the Illyrian language. For the next 1400 years, until we get to the time of Skanderbeg, the story of the Albanian people, of the Illyrian people, really is intertwined within the Roman Empire. As the Roman Empire was really in charge of the region, they conquered all the lands over Europe, you know, North Africa and the Middle East, and Albania is smack dab in the center of it. So you can't kind of talk about the Albanian past without the absorption of the Albanian society into the Roman Empire. I don't think any story about Skanderbeg would be complete without trying some Albanian food, listening to some Albanian music, and drinking some Korça Albanian beer, gazur. Because of the history, the food from Albania is very unique. It's a mix between kind of like Italian food and Ottoman food. So you get this Roman Empire sort of inspiration and connection with all of the various kingdoms that were in Italy during the time, kind of informing the food culture. And then you get this long time Ottoman, 500 years of Ottoman rule here. So you get this connection with Turkish food as well. So Albanian food is very meat heavy, very grill oriented. They do some stewed things. I think I got a lamb type stew, and it's amazing food. And the music, as you can hear, is very what we'd call Balkan. So when I talk about Balkan music, I'm talking about kind of like Turkish or Turkic beats with sort of this klezmer brass band thing that you get from kind of like the, you know, like from Austria, Germany, kind of Eastern European kind of vibe. I love the music. It has such a good spirit. To start out our meal, I've ordered a beautiful white cheese. So they do this feta here, this kind of like hard sheep's cheese that is absolutely phenomenal. Cheese in Albania, I think it's called veth or dha. It's a very interesting language. And we've got some crusty bread, so let's give it a try. We've got the cheese on the bread. A if you've never had fresh feta. It's not so creamy. It's very, it's a hard cheese, but it kind of breaks down nicely in your mouth. It's sour and salty and like really savory. I love feta. It's easily my favorite cheese, and this is like a perfect example of how good cheese can be. I'm not sure if Skanderbeg was a cheese man, but this is his story. So Albania was ruled by the Romans, and the Roman Empire, sometime after Christ, split between the Eastern Roman Empire, the Byzantine Empire, and the Western Roman Empire, which was ruled by the Pope in Rome. This meant that the Albanians, or the people that lived in this region of what we call Albania today, they were always under some sort of vassal control of the Romans. The people of Albania were originally Christian, and this was part of the Roman Empire. The Romans were, you know, very into converting people, and Albania became an important part because this was kind of the front lines of the early Crusades with the Ottomans and with the empires of the Arabian Peninsula. So this was always a controversial area where religion played a huge part in the connection of the people. And the Balkans was completely the front line of where this happened. So what happened in Albania and the Balkans really informed the future for these people and what the land would look like. So now we've got this beautiful lamb in a yogurt sauce. They do a lot of kind of stewed clay pot things and a lot of things with dairy products. They have like so many different types of yogurt, cheeses, and sour creams and things like that. So let's give this a try. It's like two lamb chops. It's we have a kidney in here, and I'm not sure what that piece is. Pretty beautiful. So good. The offal, it's extremely gamey. It's really, really lamb flavored. So if you don't like that, this is definitely not for you. I, however, really enjoy that. And it's kind of like the yogurt sauce is, there's a lot of olive oil in it. So it's almost like a emulsified bechamel. Super, super good. I can see how, you know, when you're going onto the battlefield like Skanderbeg, maybe this is what you ate because you had to stay fit. And if you're gonna have one last meal, maybe that's the way to do it.
Bon appétit.
Thank you. In the early 15th century, a man named Skanderbeg was born. Not by that name. Here is his Albanian name. You could call him George, but I prefer Skanderbeg. It's really cool. So going back to the history, the Ottomans, you know, they came up and they started conquering everything around them. So they took the Byzantine Empire, and then logically the Balkans were next. They took it. Skanderbeg was born during a time where the Ottomans controlled these large swaths of lands in the Balkans. And they didn't give up that control until the end of the Ottoman Empire, basically, in the early 1900s. It's really an incredible thing. So Skanderbeg was born at a time where the Ottomans were taking on vassal states. Typically, the Ottomans were quite religiously tolerant. Because Skanderbeg's father was the controller of this kind of, let's call it a vassal state, or this small fiefdom or region, he was forced to give one of his sons to the Ottomans to be trained as a warrior, converted to Islam, and raised as an Ottoman. The idea was that if you took the sons of these vassal leaders, of these Christian kings, and converted them to Islam and taught them the ways of the Ottomans, that those people would then come back home and, you know, have this kind of conversional effect upon the people there. Skanderbeg went to Edirne in, you know, it's like on that little top part of Turkey, very close to the Bulgarian border, where he trained to be a military leader for the Ottoman Empire. I won't bore you with the details. It's a long story, but essentially he became one of the most prolific military figures in that region of the Ottoman Empire, and he was even given a different military titles for his exploits during various Ottoman wars. He went by the name Iskender Bey. Iskender means Alexander, and Bey is a term of honor and endearment in Turkish, meaning Mr., Sir, or in this case, Captain. So you can call him Captain. Wow, I thought I was gonna get hit by a goat. You can call him Captain Alexander, which the Albanians translated into Skanderbeg. That's how the name comes together. Towards the end of his stint as a
military commander and a very fine Ottoman soldier. He was sent to lead a battalion in raids in this country as the Serbs and other Christian kingdoms of the area were fighting against the Ottomans, and the Balkans became this kind of line that the Ottomans really wanted to cross, but they were having issues, you know, kind of pushing back these people. Skanderbeg, because he was loyal to the soil, we can say, and you can say he was almost a undercover cop, you know, like getting all the way deeply into the into the interworkings of Ottoman society, he came back to this land. He came back to Albania, and he basically abandoned ship. He jumped sides, and he, along with 300 other ethnically Albanian soldiers, pushed back the Ottomans that they were fighting with, and then retook this land. Here it is. This was Skanderbeg's land. Skanderbeg then came to this spot in Kruje to establish his claim as the fief, or, you know, you can call it the vassal lord of this region. He converted back to Christianity, and he established Albania, or he tried to kind of revive this Albanian nationalism that was being subjugated by the Ottoman imperial rule. It was from watchtowers like this and castles north of Tirana in this mountainous region with swaths of valleys and land below that Skanderbeg held off various Ottoman attacks with lesser forces, and he became this sort of folk hero, this sort of king of kings for the Albanians, this more importantly, this national symbol, this unifying identity that kind of brought together various Albanian groups to kind of continue to push back against this Ottoman power. The Albanian flag today, and why it's so important in the context of today's Albania, it flies this double-headed eagle, a black eagle on a red banner. This was the almost exact, but a version of the flag that Skanderbeg flew against the Muslim invaders from the Ottoman Empire, the sign of Albanian national unity and the sign of making sure that the people were protected, that someone was looking out for the people of his land. Many argue that if it wasn't for this Christian unity that Skanderbeg fostered and the support from the Catholic Church in Rome, that the Ottoman wave of influence was going to go all the way into Europe and seemingly had no stopping point. This point with the Albanians, the Romanians, led by Vlad the Impaler, and a few other kings, were the exact reason why the Ottomans didn't get into Germany, why the Ottomans didn't take over Italy. And there's this national pride, but also European pride, that comes with the identity of Skanderbeg, which I think is very, very interesting. The reason I share this story and why I find it interesting is there's these consequential people in history that, you know, are important to some, but unknown to many. And without a guy like this, the entire Europe that we know today could be very, very different and could have played out a very different way. And so the modern Europe as it is today, the fact that the Ottomans only made it to Vienna and they never made it any farther is a testament to who this guy was. And the world we live in, you know, in one way or another, was shaped by this guy. So he's an important figure you gotta know if you enjoy history, but even if you just enjoy, you know, living in Europe and you enjoy the German culture. I mean, all of that could have been completely Ottomanized, just like Albania is today, but yet Albania is very, very much its own independent country with beautiful culture, beautiful places, and guys, come on. You have to come to Albania. It is unbelievable. So that is the story of one of the most consequential individuals that you've probably never heard of. I hope you guys learned something new. I'm not a historian, so if some of the facts are inaccurate, you know, I just love to read and I love talking about history. So if you like the video, make sure to, of course, like and subscribe. Hit the notification bell. We've got a huge series coming up from Albania, from central to north to south and everywhere in between. Food, culture, politics. You find it here on Tales from the Road first. So thank you guys for watching. Faleminderit, that's a thank you in Albanian, and we will see you in the next video.